Okay. Good day, everyone. It's a joy to be on this broadcast once more. This is our Holy Thursday service. We are coming to you from the Hogard African Methodist Episcopal Zion Church, which is located in Jackson St. Michael in the beautiful island of Barbados. We want to welcome all those who are on island as well as those who are off island. Let us have our call to worship. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. Today, we are pleased to be able once again to be in this Holy Week. And as we worship the Lord, we just ask that each person would prayerfully consider the fact that this is the week in which Jesus Christ would give up his life to save us. So we ask that you treat this service with the necessary reverence that is required. We'll have our first hymn at this point. Thank you. Crown him with many crowns. Give God thanks that we are able to crown him with our praises and with our worship. And we are pleased to have each and every one on the call at this time as we come to our prayers of praise and thanksgiving.
Let us pray. Eternal God, we approach you this evening again in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. And we come with hearts of praise and rejoicing as we celebrate this, the last night of your Son's life upon earth. We praise you, O God, for your master plan to redeem man after man had fallen away. Thank you, God, that you didn't leave mankind just to his own devices, but you plan how you would redeem him through your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, we adore you that this message, so old, is still so new and so fresh.
Yes.
Lord, we rejoice that this message of God is still today saving and transforming and renewing lives. Yes, amen. And Lord, that's why we are here tonight, because we have experienced your redemption in our life. And we say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We praise you that you are omnipotent, that you are eternal. And though there are some gods who are pretenders to your throne, you are for us the only true and living God. Hallelujah. God, we praise you that though we are not worthy in our own right, yet because of Jesus, we can declare that we are not condemned, because your Son have taken all upon himself. Lord, we thank you for the privilege that though we can't go into our church and meet others as we usually do, God, you have blessed man with knowledge and wisdom to be able to still with us together in this way. And God, we thank you in advance, because we know that tonight you're going to bless us. We ask, oh God, that as you bless us, that we might be inspired to go out into our world and bless others as well. Lord, we thank you. We praise you. We worship you.
Yes.
In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.
Praise the name of the Lord. Now we'll have our prayers of penitence. Sister Diane.
Hallelujah. Eternal and gracious Father, in the precious name of your Holy Son, Christ Jesus, we come before your throne of glory at this hour, and we bow ourselves in humble submission before you, acknowledging that you are creator and redeemer. Yes. We acknowledge at this moment that there's no other God before you or besides you. You stand alone as God eternal. Hallelujah. Alpha and Omega, Lily of the Valley, bright and morning star.
Yes.
Come before you at this hour, Lord, and we repent, Lord, of our sins. We confess our sins before you, because you told us to come bold before your throne of grace. Mm-hmm. And we come, Lord God, with a repentant heart on the behalf of our nation. Lord, we come on the behalf of Barbados tonight and we repent. We say we are sorry for the sins of your people. We stand like Moses in the gap on the behalf, Lord, of Barbados. We stand, Lord God, tonight in the name of Jesus, and we say we repent for every Caribbean island. We repent, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. Over the Caribbean seas tonight, we send Lord. Your repenting grace. We pray, Lord God, where there's wrath, you will remember mercy. Mercy will fall in the land. Lord, we ask of thee, Lord, to forgive your people of their sins. And we ask of thee, Lord Jesus, that thou will look down upon us one more time and revive our land. Lord, we need revival in the land. We need a breakthrough, Lord, of your precious, glorious grace in the land. So, Father, we ask of you to have your way. We recognize, Lord, that you are the potter, and we stand tonight as the clay. Have your sweet and mighty way in Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Let's have our second hymn, Behold the Lamb of God.
To remember
Amen. Let us say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Praise God. Now we would have our scripture readings. It's from Exodus in chapter 12. I believe it's Sister Michelle is reading for us.
Good evening, church.
Good evening.
Can everybody hear me? Because I can hardly hear.
Yes, we can hear you loud and clear.
Okay, good. So the Old Testament lesson is taken from Exodus chapter 12, verses 1 to 4, and then 11 to 14, the Passover and the festival of unleavened bread. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in Egypt, "This month is to be for you the first month, this first month of your year. Tell the whole community of Israel that on the 10th day of this month, each man is to take a lamb for his family, one for each household. If any household is too small for a whole lamb, they must share one with their nearest neighbor, having taken into account the number of people there are. You are to determine the amount of lamb needed in accordance with what each person will eat." Verse 11. "This is how you are to eat it with your..." "This is how you are to eat it, with your cloak tucked into your belt, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. Eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. On that night, I will pass through Egypt and strike down every firstborn of both people and animals, and I will bring judgment on all the gods of Egypt. I am the Lord. The blood will be a sign for you on the houses where you are, and when I see the blood, I will pass over you. No destructive plague will touch you when I strike Egypt. This is the day you are to commemorate. For the generations to come, you shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord, a lasting ordinance." This is the word of God.
And we'll have our second reading.
Now, before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour was come, that he should depart of this world unto the Father, having loved his own which were in the world, he loved them unto the end. And supper being ended, the devil, having now put into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all the things into his hand, and that he was come from God and went to God. He rose from supper and laid aside his garments and took a towel and girded himself. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel wherewith he was girded. Then cometh he to Simon Peter, and Peter saith unto him, Lord, dost thou wash my feet? Jesus answered and said unto him, What I do thou knowest not now, but thou shalt know hereafter. Peter saith unto him, Thou shalt never wash my feet. Jesus answered, If I wash thee not, thou hast no part with me. Simon Peter saith unto him, Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head. Jesus saith to him, He that is washed needeth not save to wash his feet, but is clean every bit. And ye are clean, but not all. For he knew who should betray him. Therefore said he, Ye are not all clean. So after he had washed their feet and had taken his garments and was set down again, he said unto them, Know ye what I have done to you? Ye call me Master and Lord, and ye say well, for so am I. If I then, your Lord and Master, have washed your feet, ye also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example, that ye should do as I have done to you. Verily, verily, I say unto you, the servant is not greater than his Lord, neither he that is sent greater than he that sent him. If ye know these things, happy are ye if ye do them. Therefore, when he was gone out, Jesus said, Now is the Son of the Man glorified, and God is glorified in him. If God be glorified in him, God shall also glorify him in himself, and shall straightway glorify him. Little children, yet a little while I am with you, ye shall seek me, and as I said unto the Jews, whither I go, ye cannot come. So now I say to you, a new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another as I have loved you, that ye also love one another. By this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if ye have love to one another.
Amen. Word of God for the people of God.
Amen.
Let's be to God. Thank you very much, Hannah, for reading the gospel reading for us today. Praise the Lord. We will have our next hymn. I love the Lord, He heard my cry. Amen. I love the Lord, as he heard my cry. Let us pray. Eternal and everlasting God, we do thank you for the opportunity to just express our love to you. Not because we are any different from anyone else, except that your love was extended to us and you saved us from our sins. We give you thanks, we give you praise, O God. For greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. We thank you, O God, for all that you've done for us. We thank you, Lord, for this Holy Week when we can remember that ultimate sacrifice that you paid. Bless us, O God, as we listen to your word. Speak to us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God. Once again, we want to welcome each and every one to this, our Holy Thursday. And our sermon is a little shorter because we are having a special service of Tenebrae, and we look forward to the participation of all in this service. In the scriptures, we are told that Jesus Christ had to celebrate the Passover feast in Jerusalem. And the different gospels give us different approaches as to how Jesus would come to the point where he celebrates this feast. The Passover was a Jewish feast, and for some 1,500 years before Jesus Christ, it was celebrated by the Jews who were then called Hebrews, who had been captives in Egypt. There they were forced to labor, and they looked for a Messiah. They looked for someone who would come and rid them of that burden. And God raised up a man called Moses, whose birth and his survival in itself was a miracle. However, Moses went through a period of preparation. And having been prepared, God brought him to the kingdom of the Pharaoh's Egypt. And there he requested of the Pharaoh that he allow the children of Israel to come out of Egypt so that they could worship. I find it interesting that Moses requested that they come out of Egypt to worship. We all know that their travels and their journeys would take them outside of the boundaries of Egypt onto the promised land, where God is going to develop them into a great people. But before they are released, there are a number of plagues that would take place because the Pharaoh was hard of heart and he would not easily give up this free labor that he had. And we are told that on one particular night, God passed over. And on that night, if there was not blood covering the lintels and the doorways and the windows of the homes, the firstborn in every house, whether it be Pharaoh, whether it be one of his servants, or whether it be a visitor to Egypt, the firstborn in every house would die. But for those who were covered by the blood, scripture tells us that that angel of death would pass over. And so, since that time, the Jews have celebrated the festival known as the Passover. Jesus Christ would come some 1500 years later, and he would reinterpret that festival, that feast, as they gather together around what we call today the Lord's table. We find the disciples, the women who had been following Jesus, they had all gathered together in this borrowed hall. And in that place, Jesus shared bread and wine and reinterpreted the Passover to now focus on his upcoming death through his broken body and shed blood. You may say to me, "Well, Pastor, what does that mean for me today? Here I am living some 2,200 years after the death of Jesus Christ." I want to say that that which the Hebrews celebrated as the Passover has come down to us through Jesus Christ. He has made us an integral part of an ancient feast, but with a present reality. The present reality is this, that if we participate in accepting his death as an atonement for our sins, the angel of death, that angel that comes with sin that reigns in our lives, will no longer have a hold over us, will no longer be able to control our destiny and our eternity. And so, not only will that angel pass over, but we will now have life and have it more abundantly. I want you just to see for a moment the fact that Jesus takes an ancient feast, but the power of God is still real today. That which was done in the past is able to be done today. We can place our trust in him and experience his power within our lives. You too can have a testimony that that which had a hold of your life, that which had you in chains, that which had you imprisoned, that which had you bounded, can now fall from you and you can be set free. The Spirit of God said, "Who the Son of Man sets free, they are free indeed." You can be saved from your sin. You can be saved from that impulse that we have within us to always do wrong and to resist doing right. Yes, the Passover can become a reality in the 21st century, right here in Barbados, there in London, England, or in the United States of America, wherever you may be in Trinidad or in Jamaica, wherever, because with this Passover feast, there is no distance to the power of God. Oh yes, I am excited. I'm excited because not only is there this divine articulation of salvation, but there is also a responsibility that is placed upon you and I today. What is that, you may say? I want to say this, that just as in that upper room where Jesus shared that last meal with his disciples, and he encouraged them to share with others, to share in humility, even in the washing of feet, to share in the breaking of the bread and partaking of the cup, that we too have to experience a Passover, and then as disciples, we need to pass it on. Pass it on. We need to share the goodness of the Lord Jesus Christ with someone. It is not sufficient just for us to celebrate what God has done for us in the past. We must now become custodians of the gospel, this good news, and pass it on. Pass it on. I want to suggest to you today that you may say, well, Pastor, I'm not articulate in being able to preach. I'm not able, I have not been to Bible school or theological seminary. I'm not as versed as you are in the Word of God. That's no excuse. Once you have experienced the Passover in your life, you are able to repeat the testimony of what God has done for you. And that testimony is, once I was blind, but now I see. Once I was lost, but now I'm found. Yes, we all have a responsibility before God to tell others about this good news. And until Jesus Christ comes, the church has the responsibility to pass it on, to talk and to share about how the Passover has become a reality in our lives today. Let us bow our heads for prayer. In the stillness of the moment, if you have heard the word of God, and God has spoken through this, his servant, and you realize that you do not know Jesus Christ in a personal way, here is an opportunity for you to know him. He does not want to pass you by, but he wants to stop at your house, at your door, at the door of your heart. If only at this moment you would say, come into my heart, Lord Jesus. Come in today. Come in and stay. Forgive me of my sins. He will come. He will abide with you. He will transform you, and the Passover will become a personal reality in your life. In these moments, across the airwaves, through cyberspace, God is calling you. He's saying, I sent my son, Jesus Christ, to die for your sins. Won't you accept him today? Won't you welcome him into your life? Won't you allow him to change your life, change your destiny, change your eternity? Our Heavenly Father, we pray that you would forgive us of our sins. Cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Make us into what you would have us to be. Wash us, cleanse us, mold us, fill us. We need you in our lives, O God. Help us, O God, to find you in this day of trouble. Save us from our sins. Amen. Almighty God, we pray for many who may be hearing our voice and who are living in fear because of the circumstances created by this coronavirus, this COVID-19 disease. We pray, O God, that you will bring faith in this time of fear. We pray, O God, that you will fill each and every one with faith so that they would be faithful and would see that the Lord is their shepherd and they need not want. Amen. Lord, we pray for those who have seen their loved ones pass and who are filled with grief and bereavement. Oh God, they have many questions that they would love to pose to you at this time. But we ask, oh God, that through your comforting hand, through the Holy Spirit that you sent, who is the comforter, that you will draw near to them and take them in your arms, cuddle them, O God, and just shed your love all over them in this time of loss. Amen. Finally, God, we pray for the leaders of our nations. We ask, O God, that you give them wisdom as they seek to guide the people within their nations. Give wisdom, give knowledge, give understanding. We pray, O God, that you will be their assurance. You will be their buckler and their shield. That you, O God, will be alongside them in all their decision making. Lord, we pray that they will find within their toolkit righteousness. For your word tells us righteousness exalts the nation. Lord, may they seek to lead a life of righteousness and to lead the nation in righteousness. This we ask in your precious and holy name. Amen and amen. Praise the Lord. We give God thanks for this opportunity to be able to give testimony to his name. As we come towards the service of Tenebrae, we ask that all would participate as we remember Jesus moving into the Garden of Gethsemane. This would be a dark time in the life of Jesus Christ as he feels the weight of sin coming upon him and the abandonment of those who were close to him. We now want to begin our service of Tenebrae. Our first hymn is Go to Dark Gethsemane. after which we would be led in the shadow of betrayal by Reverend Arlene Joseph. Reverend Joseph. Reverend Arlene Joseph.
I'm not hearing that well.
The shadow of betrayal, please read.
I haven't got anything prepared to do that because I didn't know I had to do something.
Okay.
Okay, would Sister Pamela Wall or Sister Penny Lee Nurse please stand in?
Go ahead, Sister Penny. We're not hearing Sister Pam.
Let Pam read it. Can please read it.
The shadow of betrayal. When it was evening, he took his place with the 12. And while they were eating, he said, "Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me." And they became greatly distressed and began to say to him one after another, "Surely, Lord." He answered, "The one who has dipped his hand into the bowl with me will betray me. The Son of Man goes as it is written of him. But woe to that one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one not to have been born." Judas, who betrayed him, said, "Surely not I, Rabbi." He replied, "You have said so."
A shadow of denial foretold. Michelle Trotman.
The shadow of the denial foretold. Then Jesus said to them, "You will all become deserters because of me this night, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. But after I am raised up, I will go ahead of you to Galilee." Peter said to him, "Though all become deserters because of you, I will never desert you." Jesus said to him, "Truly I tell you, this very night, before the cock crows, you will deny me 3 times. Peter said to him, "Even though I must die with you, I will not deny you." And so said all the disciples.
In Man of Sorrows.
We're going to mash it down over here. Thank you.
The shadow. Go ahead.
The shadow of the agony of spirit. Jesus prays in Gethsemane. They went to a place called Gethsemane. And he said to his disciples, sit here while I pray. He took with him Peter and James and John and began to be distressed and agitated. And he said to them, I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and keep awake. And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. He said, Abba, Father, for you all things are possible. Remove this cup from me, yet not what I want, but what you want. He came and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter, Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep awake 1 hour? Keep awake and pray that you may not come into time of trouble. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. And again he went away and prayed, saying the same words. And once more he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were very heavy, and they did not know what to say to him. He came a third time and said to them, are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Enough, the hour has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners.
The shadow of the rest, Matthew 26, 47 to 52. The betrayal and arrest of Jesus. While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With him was a large crowd with swords and clubs, from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now, the betrayer had given a sign saying, the one I will kiss is the man, arrest him. At once he came up to Jesus and said, greetings, Rabbi, and kissed him. Jesus said to him, friend, do what you are here to do. Then they came and laid hands on Jesus and arrested him. Suddenly, one of those with Jesus put his hand onward, drew it, and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to him, put your sword back into its place, for all who take the sword will perish by the sword.
The shadow of denial, Sister Maureen.
Yeah. What happened here?
Okay. Then they seized him and led him away, bringing him into the high priest's house. But Peter was following at a distance. When they had kindled a fire in the middle of the courtyard and sat down together, Peter sat among them. Then a servant girl, seeing him in the firelight, stared at him and said, "This man also was with him." But he denied it, saying, "Woman, I do not know him." A little later, someone else, on seeing him, said, "You also are one of them." But Peter said, "Man, I am not." Then about an hour later, yet another kept insisting, "Surely this man also was with him, for he is a Galilean." But Peter said, "Man, I do not know what you are talking about." At that moment, while he was still speaking, the cock crowed. The Lord turned and looked at Peter. Then Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said to him, "Before the cock crows today, you will deny me three times." And he went out and wept bitterly.
Sister Diana?
Yes, yes, babe. Then Pilate entered the praetorium again, called Jesus and said to him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered him, "Are you speaking for yourself about this, or did others tell you this concerning me?" Pilate answered, "Am I a Jew? Your own nation and the chief priests have delivered you to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would fight so that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But no, my kingdom is not from here. Pilate therefore said to him, are you a king then? Jesus answered, you say rightly that I am a king. For this cause I was born, and for this cause I have come into the world, that I should bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice. Pilate said to him, what is truth? And when he had said this, he went out again to the Jews and said to them, I find no fault in him at all.
Shadow of the Crucifixion, Vandilene.
And Jesus sentenced to death. And after he had said this, he went out to the Jews again and told them, I find no case against him. The shadow of crucifixion. Now the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus killed. The governor again said to them, which of the two do you want me to release to you? And they said, Barabbas. And Pilate said to them, then what shall I do with Jesus, who is called the Messiah? All of them said, let him be crucified. Then he asked, why? What evil has he done? But they all shouted all the more, let him be crucified.
Pilate hands Jesus over to be crucified. So when Pilate saw that he could do nothing, but rather that a riot was beginning, he took some water and washed his hands before the crowd, saying, I am innocent of this man's blood. See to it yourselves. Then the people as a whole answered, his blood be on us and on our children. So he released Barabbas for them. And after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified. The shadow of humiliation. Then the soldiers led him into the courtyard of the palace, that is, the governor's headquarters. And they called together the whole cohort. And they clothed him in a purple cloak. And after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on him and they began saluting him. Hail, King of the Jews! They struck his head with a reed, sat upon him, and knelt down in homage to him. After mocking him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him.
My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from helping me from the words of my groaning? Oh my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer. and by night, but find no rest. Yet you are holy, enthroned on the praises of Israel. In you our ancestors trusted. They trusted and you delivered them. To you they cried and were saved. In you they trusted and were not put to shame. But I am a worm and not human, scorned by others and despised by the people. All who see me mock at me. They make mouths at me. They shake their heads. Commit your cause to the Lord. Let him deliver. Let him rescue the one in whom he delights. Yet it was you who took me from the womb. You kept me safe on my mother's breast. On you I was cast from my birth. And since my mother bore me, you have been my God. Do not be far from me, for trouble is near, and there is no one to help. Many bulls encircle me. Strong bulls of Bashan surround me. They open wide their mouths at me like a ravening and roaring lion. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It is melted within my breast. My mouth is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue sticks to my jaws. You lay me in the dust of death. For dogs are all around me. A company of evildoers encircle me. My hands and feet have shriveled. I can count on my bones. They stare and gloat over me. They divide my clothes among themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots. But you, O Lord, do not be far away. O my help, come quickly to my aid. Deliver my soul from the sword, my life from the power of the dog. Save me from the mouth of the lion, from the horns of the wild oxen. You have rescued me. May Jesus Christ, who for our sakes became obedient unto death, even death on a cross, keep you and strengthened you. Amen.